three gods, but when you take it out of the Jewish context, you can see how the early fathers struggled with sort of tritheism on the one hand and modalism on the other. But I think the answer to all of that is go back to the first century Jewish world and understand this idea of the promise that one day God will come back and reveal his glory. Yes. And he'll come back in person. And then John's Gospel and Paul, especially in Romans, yes, say that's exactly what God has done in Jesus, and it is exactly what God is doing by the Spirit. Yes. And so this is biblical God language framed within the first century Jewish world about Jesus and the Spirit. And somehow we have to say, if the doctrine of the Trinity didn't exist, it would be necessary to invent it. Yes. But actually, I think the biblical way of doing it is more profound than anything that the early fathers get to. And you know, the fathers did a good job of summing it all up, but they were always in danger of leaving behind that dynamic early Jewish way of talking about God. So there's all sorts of issues out of that, but that's where I would start to address it.
Yes. So who is God for you?
When I use the word God, I'm talking about the Creator, the one who made the whole world and who loves the whole world, and the one who will put the whole world right at the end. Creation, and in that sense judgment, in the biblical sense of putting everything right.
Yes.
But the reason that I can hold on to that belief, which is obviously contested by all kinds of things in the world that we know, is because of Jesus and the Spirit. That in Jesus, I see the personal presence and love of this one God, but I understand more both about creation and about the ultimate putting right of all things. And then in the Spirit, when I invoke the Spirit day by day and I say, come Holy Spirit and enable me to be part of your purposes in the world, I'm invoking the Spirit who, from one point of view, is the breath of Jesus himself. From another point of view, is the breath of the Creator God himself, yes, and in both cases leading towards the putting right of all things. So I am worshipping and loving and invoking the God who we know in Jesus and by the Spirit, but the God who in Jesus and the Spirit reveals himself as the Creator and the Consummator of the world.
Yes, yes. So when it comes to the doctrine of Trinity and monotheism, the question we have is, do Christians and Muslims worship Islam?
That's an interesting question. I'm not an expert on Islam, but I have done a little bit of Christian-Muslim, yeah, dialogue and reading the Scriptural Reasoning Project, you may know about, where you have Christians, Jews and Muslims reading New Testament, Torah and, yes, and Quran. And so I've learnt a little bit from that. And I've also lived in the Middle East briefly and talked to Palestinian clergy and about their relations with local Muslim communities. Yes. And several people from that context will say, our Muslim neighbours are our friends, our brothers and sisters, we know them, we get on fine, but it is clear this is not the same God. Because if the God we see in the Bible is defined in terms of Jesus and particularly his death and resurrection, okay, then that is what the Muslim will say, that's impossible.
Yes.
But the Muslims will say that God is the Creator and God has purposes for the world which will finally be worked out. And to that extent, then that sounds very like the God that Jews and Christians worship over against, say, the gods in Hinduism or something like that. Mm-hmm. So it depends where you're starting. And if you're starting from a secularist point of view, the Muslim Allah is much more like the Christian God than, again, something that a secularist might imagine as God or an Epicurean might imagine, yeah, as God. But when you then focus in and talk about Jesus and the Spirit and talk about suffering and crucifixion and the patient, generous love of God, then I think we are saying something different about God. Of course, some theologians will say, well, that's our vision, the Muslims have their vision, but ultimately God is behind that. I think in the New Testament, one of the most extraordinary claims, John chapter 1, verse 18, and also Colossians 1 and Hebrews 1,
yes,
is that humans by themselves don't have a very clear view of God. They have a sense of God, and in the Old Testament, of course, very powerful, but we ultimately only know who God is when we see Jesus.
Yes.
And for me, that is a statement of rock-bottom Christian truth.
Yeah, so we know God the Father through Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So God is defined by Jesus Christ.
And I want to say we know God the Creator through, as I said before, when we think about Jesus going about and doing what he did and healing the sick and then we say, supposing when we say creation was made, or you know, Paul says all things are made in and through and for him, Colossians 1, and John says the Word was with God, the Word was God, all things were made through him. And in 1 Corinthians 8, Paul says there's one God, the Father, from whom are all things, and one God, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things. Yeah. Well, we know Jesus. We know what it might look like to say that all things are made through him. An extraordinary idea. Yes. This is how God made the world. So I want to push back to a doctrine of creation, shaped not just by a sort of a cosmic Christ figure, but by actually Jesus himself, because there is only one Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Jesus is the Christ, but yeah.
Yes, yes. Some Christians see the crucifixion of Jesus Christ as a problem. Well, some Christians, especially evangelical Christians, see the crucifixion of Christ as the ground for Christian faith theology. So what do you want to comment on this point?
Yeah, obviously I wrote a big book on this just a couple of years ago, the day the revolution began.
Yes. I haven't read it yet.
Right, okay. But it's very difficult when you're doing New Testament theology to get things balanced. In the New Testament, the crucifixion is always the crucifixion of the one who was then raised from the dead.
Yes.
And the resurrection is always the resurrection of the crucified one. So you have to hold on to those two together, because by the evening of Good Friday, when Jesus was crucified, none of his followers were saying, well, that was all very nasty, but he's died for our sins, so that's fine. They were saying, we followed the wrong man. We were mistaken. We thought he was the Messiah, like the two on the road to Emmaus. We thought he was the one who had redeemed Israel, but he obviously wasn't. So the resurrection then says, actually he was, and this is how he did it. So you need the resurrection to explain what actually happened on the cross. And you need the cross to explain that the resurrection is the new life of the redeemed world and the beginning of new creation. So for me, those events are absolutely central and non-negotiable. But the problem is, because they are so huge, they are difficult to understand in all their full biblical resonance. And so Christians tend to get a little theory about this or that, and then they put those theories into a different narrative, say the narrative that we have to leave this world and go to a different place called heaven, which is so popular in Western theology. And then they make the cross and resurrection part of that story, which distorts them quite radically.
Yes. And some non-Christians, especially Buddhists in my country, Myanmar, the Buddhist monk recently wrote a book. The title of that book is in Burmese, I mean in English, The God Who Killed His Son. When we see the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, what comes to the mind of other non-Christians that God killed his own son.
Why
do you want to respond to this?
Well, clearly, as we were saying before, John 3, but also many, many other passages, that the New Testament emphatically holds on to the belief that Jesus himself was the living embodiment of Israel's God. And that therefore, I mean, you need some sort of a beginning of a doctrine of the Trinity to hold on to that. Romans 8, Paul says, he did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. That's very different to saying he killed him. He gave him up, and what killed him was the wickedness of the world. In Acts 4, when the disciples are praying after they've been threatened by the authorities, they take Psalm 2 and they say that the nations raged and all the rest of it. They said, in this city, Herod and Pilate got together to put him to death. And it was the wickedness and evil of the world that killed him. But God was in the middle of that, drawing onto himself the force and power of evil in order to exhaust the force and power of evil. That's how it works.
Yes.
So, but I can understand that particularly when people hear Christians talking about the cross. Yeah. Sometimes Christians can give people the wrong impression,
exactly, yeah.
And they pick that up.
Yeah, the problem for Buddhists, at best, really, is that their doctrine of nonviolence is contradicted to the death of Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Well, I see that, and that's a problem for Christians today, because there are many Christians in the West, particularly, who, having lived with this, basically, it's a medieval vision of an angry, violent God. Then they say, well, there you are, if we want to solve the problems of the world, we have to go and do some violence. And so the idea of redemptive violence works its way through into society and politics and into domestic violence and all sorts of things. And people justify that in terms of, well, you know, God did this. I've heard people arguing like this, that we have to do violence because, after all, God embraced violence when he...
And this is
actually blasphemous. What we see in the New Testament is the God of utter self-giving love, and you know, the New Testament is an extraordinary book. You know, here it is, a tiny little book, one of the smallest holy books in the world, but it's just full of this amazing, awe-inspiring idea that the God who made the world is a God of utter self-giving love.
And some Christians, especially the liberal Christians, claim that Jesus did not come into the world to die on the cross, but to establish his kingdom. So his death on the cross is a consequence of his solidarity with the poor and of his people. So
I would say that among the many, many, many reasons why Jesus died was his solidarity with the people who were waiting for God's kingdom, who were the poor and the etc. The common people heard him gladly. The New Testament says that again and again. And when Jesus dies on the cross with brigands either side of him, these are revolutionaries. They're not common criminals. They're revolutionaries. And it's as though the New Testament is saying Jesus is identifying with their cause, even though he was not himself a violent revolutionary. So I want to say that's part of it. But I then say, look inside that. And each of the gospel writers in their own way, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, they do it differently, but it all comes back to the same thing, that the Messiah died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. So this is the long narrative from Genesis and Exodus, Deuteronomy, Isaiah and Psalms. It's this story which is coming to fruition, which does involve God coming and sharing the lot of the poor and the needy. But in order to do something much bigger, this is not just a social project, in other words. The social project is part of it, but we have to grasp the much larger whole. And I think the reason that liberal theologians have done that is because they have seen conservative theologians saying that the only thing that matters is we need to get to heaven, Jesus has to die for our sins, so who cares about this world? And that is just as much a nonsense as what the liberals do by way of response. So I want to say, no, sorry, the Bible is telling a very different story from either of those.
Yes. When it comes to the crucifying God, Woodman becomes important. So let's move a little bit to Woodman theology of the crucifying God. Woodman famously claims in his book, The Crucifying God, and in his other book, The Passion for God, what he said is traditional theology teaches that God dies for us. But that is not enough to talk about the crucifying God. What we have to add is Jesus died for God's self. So by dying for God's self, Jesus brings God's solidarity with the oppressed and the poor today.
Yeah.
And by dying for us, Jesus brings us back into a communion with God, kind of a reconciliation, Christology.
Yeah.
So is it biblical, and what do you want to comment on?
I'm not unhappy with that as a summary of some aspects of what we find in the New Testament. I want to see this much more rooted in that great Old Testament story. Because the death of Jesus means what it means in relation to the whole of the scriptural narrative. Because it's very interesting, you said before as well, some people say it's Jesus about the kingdom and others saying about the cross. As far as I can see, all four Gospels talk about kingdom and cross like this together. The kingdom is brought ultimately by means of the cross.
Yes.
And to understand this, and I think Moltmann would probably be happy with this, I'm not sure.
Have you met him personally?
Yeah, I have met him personally two or three times, but we've never actually had this conversation. I want to say that in the New Testament there is this strange, rather dark theme which ends up with the Christus Victor language of atonement. where because human beings worship forces within nature which become divinized, they worship idols which are not actually gods, but human beings worship money or power or sex or fame or whatever it is, then we give those forces within the world power over us, which actually should have been our human power as image bearers of the Creator. But as a result, the power of those powers needs to be broken.
Yes.
It's no good simply to say we have to try a bit harder to make the world a better place, and Jesus dying helped us to do that. In John chapter 12, which has become very important for me in recent years, Jesus says, as he looks ahead to the cross, now is the judgment of this world, now is the ruler of this world cast out, and if I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself.
Yes.
And so there's a sense that the powers that have taken over the world need to be defeated and dethroned in order that then God's kingdom will be effected. So what Jesus is doing in his ministry, in his public career, is planting the seeds of the kingdom, but that work depends on the fact that he's going to do what he does on the cross. And likewise, the cross is the completion of his kingdom work. We need to have that together. So I then want to say, yes, part of that is God in person coming to the place where the world is in pain. And if you want to cash that out in terms of feasting with the sinners and so on, yes, of course, that's big, especially in Luke's gospel.
Yes.
But it's all part of this larger Jewish vision of the kingdom.
Yes. And it seems to us that the four gospels focus on God's kingdom, or the kingdom of heaven,
yeah,
in the language of Matthew.
Matthew, yeah.
Well, Paul's focus on the doctrine of redemption, justification, and salvation. So the question here is, can we assume that the gospel account of God's kingdom is the same concept of Paul's doctrine of justification and salvation?
Yeah, I think in both cases, what we have to do one more time is to go back and say, they are all saying what God promised from the beginning, in Genesis right the way on through, this is what has now come to pass in Jesus. Now, when you are in Galilee and Jerusalem in, say, 29 AD, the main thing to say is the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. When you are Paul going around bringing Gentiles into the kingdom, they need to know, how does that work? And Jewish Christians who are suspicious need to know, how come they are part of the same family? And so Paul has to develop the doctrine of justification and reconciliation particularly because he's addressing a new situation. But in both cases, this is the great scriptural story which has reached its fulfillment in Israel's Messiah. And it's what I call messianic eschatology. It's saying that which you have been waiting for has arrived in the person of Jesus and now in the power of the Spirit. But, of course, the Gentile world wasn't waiting for a Messiah, certainly not for a Jewish leader. Why would the Gentile world want that? So when in Paul's theology, as he's teaching these non-Jewish early Christians, he is addressing issues that Jesus never had to address, which is why there are all sorts of issues that Jesus never spoke about, because in the Jewish world he didn't need to, but Paul needed to address those things. So it isn't that Jesus is the teacher of a new theology and then Paul teaches something different. Jesus is like the person who writes a great piece of music, and Paul is like the person who goes around and teaches people to sing it who had never done any singing before. And so naturally they're doing different kinds of things.
Yes. The concept of salvation is multi-dimensional.
Yes.
So some think of salvation as being saved from hell, while some think of it as about going to heaven. So what it actually means by being saved, according to the Bible?
Being saved is being rescued. And what are we rescued from? And ultimately, the dark force of all dark forces is death itself. Because God is the good creator who made a good and glorious world and wants to rescue that whole world, which is why the biblical view of salvation is about new creation. That God is rescuing the world from death and everything that causes death. And what causes death is partly idolatry, which then produces sin, so it's global death and personal death. And you can cash that out in terms of hell, etc. as well.
Yes.
But so that the rescue then is not a Platonic rescue of a soul leaving the world of space, time and matter and going somewhere else. If you want to know who teaches that in the first century, it's Plutarch, who is a Neoplaton, a Middle Platonist. Plutarch has a whole essay in which he says that we humans are exiled from our true home in heaven, and one day our souls will happily leave this body and go back to heaven where we really belong.
Yes.
And I get so frustrated because a lot of Christians think that that's what Paul taught, but it isn't. That's a pagan philosopher called Plutarch. And that what Paul is teaching is that one day God will make new heavens and new earth,
yes,
because the heaven and the earth were always meant to go together, to work together. And humans were meant to be at the heart of that. That's salvation. That's being rescued from the falling apart of creation in order to be part of God's ultimate new creation.
Thank you. That's very impressive. There's always a debate among traditional readers of Paul and the new readers of Paul. And I understand that you represent the new reading of Paul. And what is the main difference between a traditional reading of Paul and a new reading of Paul?
Yeah, this is tricky because there has been a lot of excitement and anxiety about that. And I think if anyone wants to follow that up, the place where I've spelt all that out is in the book I referred to a while ago, Paul and His Recent Interpreters, where I discuss the work of Ed Sanders and James Dunn,
yes,
Francis Watson and many others, as well as the apocalyptic readings of Paul, so-called, and the sociological readings of Paul.
Mm.
And the part of the difficulty with Paul at the moment is that there are many different scholarly conversations going on, and they're not really related to each other. For me, the important thing is that Paul was a first century Jew, and he's writing what he's writing from the perspective of a first century Jew. And if we go and read Josephus or 4th Ezra or 1 Enoch or any of these Jewish books of the time, Jews are not discussing how to go to heaven. As I say, that's a Platonic concern. They are discussing the question of when is God going to do what he's promised? When is he going to rescue Israel? And what will it look like when he does? And if he's going to send a Messiah, what will the Messiah have to do? And who might be the Messiah? And they've got different movements. So when you put Paul into that world, so much of what he says makes extraordinarily good sense in a way that it doesn't if you start in, say, the 16th century and say, oh dear, we are wicked sinners, and we have learned from our medieval teachers that there is this angry God and hell and all that, how does he save us? And the old perspective, so-called, from Luther and Calvin, is trying to give biblical answers to medieval questions. And I want to say we have to get the first century questions. It's much better to get biblical answers to medieval questions than non-biblical answers to medieval questions. Much better to find out what were the real questions Paul himself was addressing. For me, this all began with Galatians. I was studying Galatians and Romans in the mid-1970s before Ed Sanders' book was published. And I realized that Galatians 2, for instance, is not about how to go to heaven. It's not about salvation. It's about, here we are in Antioch, here are some uncircumcised Gentile believers in Jesus,